everybody. Welcome to the SoxProspects.com podcast. It's episode number 211. We are the web's number one source for information on the Boston Red Sox farm system from top to bottom, from Fort Myers to Worcester, up the Pike to Fenway, and all stops in between. Thank you for listening. My name is Chris Hatfield. I am the executive editor of Sox Prospects, and I am joined, as always, by our director of scouting, Ian Kundle. Ian, it is Memorial Day weekend. Hope you had an excellent holiday, and I hope all of our listeners out there had an excellent holiday and took a minute to think about the reason for the holiday. Thanks to those men and women who serve our country and who have served our country, we take a moment to think of you all this weekend. Ian, what's been on the agenda for you over this long weekend? A lot of baseball, I hope.
It was raining most of the weekend. That's here, so, and in like the 40s, so that wasn't ideal. Had a little grill tonight, so that was nice.
Nice. I almost flooded my car driving to Ocean City.
Because it was how much it was raining.
Because it was raining, and I guess the way we literally drove through a flood area, and I think my car might be a little messed up.
Oh yeah, don't you have like a little car still?
So, I have a sedan. It's not a little car. I don't have a mini.
It's a little. That's interesting. It was just weird that last week it was the 90s, and then Memorial Day weekend when everything's opened up in Massachusetts, and spirits are doing good, and it's in the 40s and raining, or 50s and raining, and it's like, oh, this is fun.
That's some BS.
Yeah, but thankfully the rain held off today, so some outside time today, which was nice.
Indeed. Well, we've got some stuff to talk about here on the podcast today. We're talking about Franchy Cordero finally getting demoted to Worcester and responding with a couple of bombs. We've got new rankings.
Sorry to chime in. That's the most predictable thing ever, right? Everyone knew this was coming.
But we've got new rankings to talk about, and we've got, as always, your emails. You can email the show at podcast@soxprospects.com. We want to talk about what you want to hear about, so send us your thoughts, questions, concerns, and we will get to them on the show. And as always, if you want to support the podcast, you can do two things. First, I haven't mentioned this in a while, but give us a rating and review on Apple Podcasts. We would appreciate that. And if you want to support the show financially, you can go to patreon.com/soxprospects. And as always, we want to shout out our $5 and up level Patreon supporters. That ever-growing list includes Kyle Costigan, taking a breath after the first name this time, Tyler Woodrall, Jeff Traynor, David Nardone, Tim Harding, Bill Stanton, Deb Kendall, Evan Kirkwood, Hurricanes 1, Chris Fox, James O'Hara, Nathan Kenyon, Andrew Wallen, David B., Ben Burnett, Al Mendel, Kevin Catrides, Ben NRI, Paul Denyer, Lendl Martin, Cassandra Buchta, James B. McMahon, Stephen Gregory, James Bailey, Andreas Gullstrand, Corey Perrick, Forrest Perkins, Mark Herman, Aaron Mehta, Jeff Harwood, Jimmy Mountain, Brian Cowan, Dusty G., and Pavel. Thank you all for your support. Again, that's patreon.com/soxprospects. And Ian, I suggest we dive right in to the news of the week. And the first is the demotion on Thursday of Franchy Cordero to Worcester. Ian, I think it's just a matter of it had kind of come to a head. Cordero wasn't starting anymore. He was the left hand, the weak side of a platoon in the outfield where
he would have been the strong side.
Or the strong side. So he wasn't playing.
But he wasn't in a platoon. Bench outfielder.
He was just a bench outfielder at this point. That's right.
Yeah.
Especially with now that Danny Santana is up, it seems like what they're doing basically is they're like platooning Santana with Arroyo, and they're kind of platooning Marwin Gonzalez with Bobby Dalbec now, which is interesting. And maybe we should, we didn't talk about this when we were prepping, but maybe worth discussing once we get done with Cordero. Just the major league lineup right now, where Dalbec appears to be on the weak side of a platoon.
Which is weird, though, because Marwin Gonzalez has been terrible this year.
Well, at the plate, but he's been by far their best defender.
No, I know that, but he's hitting 194 this year, and last year he had 211. Like, we're at approaching a 300 at bat sample.
Yeah, he's not hitting, but he's defensively been tremendous. He was like five outs above average or something, on Baseball Savant.
But it's just, I do think that if you're looking for an area that they need to address, first base is going to be the one we're going to talk about, because you just can't have this type of production from your first base position. Dalbec, do you know what Dalbec's strikeout to walk ratio is this year?
I might as well just say it rather than belabor it.
54 strikeouts to 9 walks and 149 PAs.
Yeah, that's not good.
Is the kind of concerning thing we talked about with him at nauseam in the past.
And, This is why
scouts were down on him.
Like, this is why I never bought him as a top 100 guy. BA had him in their top 100, and I never bought it.
He's rocking a 36% K rate at the big leagues this year, down from 42% last year. But like, that's not going to play. Like, it's just not.
And he keeps showing flashes, is the frustrating thing. But look, I'm not ready to demote him as quickly as they demoted Franchy, right? Because I could see him staying up, working with the major league hitting coaches, you know, trying to figure out what he needs to do to get back to doing what he did last year in the major leagues, but again, in a weird year.
But the thing is, last year he was still rocking a 42% K
rate.
Like,
right, it wasn't sustainable. What happened, yeah.
Like, that's why, like, he was never, like, our top prospect or in consideration for that.
No, I think we had him, like, fifth or sixth, which was, like, middle of the road.
Because he's like a 45. He's like an up and down, like bench strong, like weak side of a platoon bat, most likely. That was like, the hit tool is just not good enough, I don't think, to play at the big league level. And we're kind of seeing that. He's getting exposed again. And like, I don't know if they're going to do something about it right now, as you said, but that platoon at first base, which is supposed to be one of your primary offensive positions, is just not going to cut it if you're trying to be a championship
level.
Well,
it's weird because what they're doing, the lineup against righties is Kike Hernandez in center, Marwin Gonzalez at second, Danny Santana at first. The lineup against lefties is... what is it? It's a... Oh, okay. So Hernandez is like always in center now. Arroyo plays second and Dahlbeck plays first. And Renfro and Dahlbeck hit higher in the order is what it is. And like Verdugo's now your full-time left fielder. It's weird. It's because for a while the platoon was Danny Santana and Christian, not for a while, like a couple of games. It was Danny,
like two games.
Yeah, it was Arroyo plays second against lefties. Santana plays center and pushes Hernandez to second against righties, I think. Right? Does that make sense? Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But it's just like, do you see what I'm saying about the first base? Because it's just they're in a weird situation where that is like a marquee offensive position and you're running out a duo that's like in a weird way is a combined like 200 average.
Well, but that's why, like, you know, with Marwin Gonzalez being in a platoon, like you can take Marwin Gonzalez's production at second base, right? Because second base is, because it's the second worst hitting position in the majors right now next to catcher. I mean, you can, if he can make it up on defense, you can take that. You just can't have three guys doing that, which is the problem they've run into all year.
He's hitting 199. Like, I'm sorry, but like, if I'm the Red Sox, I'm not accepting someone hitting 199, 292, 284.
Well, you're not extending him. It's like,
no, accepting it. Like, I don't think you could. My point is that is not like an area that I would be confident in heading into a championship if you're trying to compete.
It's a 292 on base, which is not good, but it's still not as, I mean, it's 100. Well, it's, you know, better than his BA.
It's a 64 WRC plus.
Yeah, it's not good. That's what I'm saying. But it's just, again, on defense. Let me see here. I mean, on BREF, I'm on his register page. It's not going to have B war. But I mean, again, I mean, bringing it back to Dahlbeck, I just think you know, you give him another month to figure it out. And if he doesn't, you have to send him down because you're now in second place because the Rays are on fire.
I mean, the Rays are absurd. Like, it's where the Rich hell Hill is like the best pitcher in baseball all of a sudden.
Yeah. Like, where did that come from? Somehow I clicked on his 2011 Tennessee Smokies roster. But yeah, you at some point need to start going for it. And that's what they're starting to do. That's Cordero going down, right? Like, that's, you know, what is Gonzalez giving you? Player value. Yeah, he's a positive war contributor because of his defense on Baseball Reference.
Yeah, on Fangraphs he's negative because it was what is his, like, I'm trying to find
his baseball reference wins above replacement is half of a win. So he's like a one-win player because of his defense, because his offensive war is like -0.1 and his defensive is +0.6.
Yeah, on Fangraphs, he's -0.1. It's not a lot, but yeah.
So he's a basically replacement-level player, which is not great. You don't want like five replacement-level players in your lineup, but you can take a replacement-level guy as a platoon at second base.
Hmm. I just don't think it's good enough.
They've got holes. I'm not saying they don't have holes, but
I just think for how much he's getting paid, what, $3 million a year? Which like, is I nothing. Guess that's replacement level.
Yeah, that's nothing for on a one-year deal.
I just don't think that if they're and they are wanting to go for it, I think first base is the position, and it's the Gonzalez-Dahlbeck combo that needs is going to be in the line to get replaced if they do actually try decide to go
Well, because Danny Santana is, again, your strong side first baseman right now. And I don't think Santana's going anywhere. It does seem like Santana's playing his way into being an everyday player. But like,
no, I mean, he's 10 strikeouts and 20 at-bats. Like, okay. It's Danny Santana.
Okay, so he's striking out a lot. I know he had a couple of home runs in the first
He's hitting 150, 261. Okay. His only hits are actually the home runs.
He's come back down to earth. All right, fair enough. Yeah, I mean, they're trying Santana out. They're trying Gonzalez out. Like, we'll see where it leads. But it, again, getting back to Dahlbeck. You know, I think you let him stay down against right-handers for a bit and beat up on lefties, but you eventually have to try him out. Or maybe this is what he is now. Maybe they just say, hey, this is what he is, the way that they've said this is what Michael Chavis is. You know, I'm after Michael Chavis had that great spring, everyone was like, oh, why is he getting demoted? Bring him up, send down Cordero, and it's like he comes up and he can't stop himself from chasing balls.
Yeah, like, I mean, and I will say Dahlbeck is crushing lefties. He's hitting .314 with a .627 slugging against lefties.
And it's weird because he didn't have this reverse split. He didn't have this bad of a split in the minors.
No, he's hitting .148 against righties, and he can't touch velocity, which is, I think, the most concerning thing. Is like, I think at 95 plus, he's hitting, I want to say it's under .150 or something. Mm-hmm. But it's I don't have the numbers in front. I'd have to bring it up. But it's not good at all.
Yeah, it's not. And then Cordero, of course, Ian, gets optioned in immediately to tanks.
Yeah, I mean, that's what he is. Like, is I said on Twitter after I got asked about Cordero, my thing is like, you had to send him down because he's someone that you're not going to give up on after, what is it, 38 games or whatever?
Yeah.
Because he's still so, there's so much raw ability in there, and he needs to be playing every day, and I think it'll be good for him just to get every day at bats. He knows he's going to be playing every day, and he can work with the dev staff and kind of try to figure it out. And yeah, I mean, he's hitting, like, he's got two bombs in what, three games since he's been demoted, and they're just legit tanks. And he's just got to figure out that approach and just get back to hitting the baseball. And right. I think just take some pressure off him, because I still do think there's someone who could at least be a platoon bat at some point.
Yeah. Yeah, certainly. I mean, and they'll see what he can do down there. And I guess maybe that's a good spot to transition, Ian. We wanted to mention that Chris Cotillo is reporting that the player to be named later from the Mets in the Benintendi trade needs to be identified by the end of this week. So that should be coming soon.
We should specify this is the work week, not the week.
End of the work week, yeah. Yeah, okay, yeah. And then Lynn Worthy is a beat reporter for the Royals, for the Kansas City Star. And Lynn reported that, we reported hearing that the Red Sox could decide on players to be named later to finalize for trade to the Royals as soon as the next week or two. So that would be the Royals players. So it sounds like we're going to start hearing about them soon. And the thing we wanted to mention is be prepared for them to be lower minors type players. Because the Red Sox, we're not going to get into the whole thing now, but they have a Rule 5 roster crunch coming this offseason with as many as 10 guys that they might need to add.
11.
As many as 11, yeah, that they might need to add if things continue the way they're going, or at least we'll have to consider adding. Not that they will have to add.
There's right. Like,
there's like five guys they need to add, and we can list them. It's if they're not already on the roster, which Jaron Duran will be, but it's Duran, Downs, Gilberto Jimenez, Thaddeus Ward, and who is the other one, Ian? Help me.
Brian Baio,
who we'll talk about in a minute, who are all looking like obvious adds. Although who knows what happens with Ward.
Well, that's what I was about to say. If he has TJ, maybe he doesn't.
Maybe
like,
they
if
can
he gets
get away
Garrett
with it.
Whitlock. But Garrett Whitlock, that's like the example.
Well, but Whitlock would be like if they didn't protect him next offseason.
Well, no, because Whitlock had it in
2019.
Yeah, and then they didn't.
And then they drafted him at the end of 2020. So with Ward, he would get Tommy John.
And he wasn't Rule 5 eligible though. In
right,
that year.
But my point is that Whitlock was more than a year out from the surgery when they picked him.
Yeah, I mean, he was a year. He was like 18 months out or 16
Right.
months
That's
out. Yeah.
what I'm saying. So the equivalent would be if they didn't protect him in 2022, which isn't going to happen.
Well, and
Anyway.
also, we don't know if he's having surgery either.
Well,
So.
right. Yeah. Let's, good point. Good point. But yeah, there's a lot of guys they're going to have to protect. So expect them not to be guys who the Red Sox are going to have to protect this coming off season. But we'll keep an eye out for that as well. But yeah, I mean, really, Ian, that's all we want to hit on news. Also, we should mention the Olympic qualifier. The Olympic qualifying tournament for the Americas started today, Monday the 31st. On Team USA, both Jarren Duran and Tristan Casas had a couple of singles tonight. For Team Colombia, Jeter Downs and his brother Jerry both went 0 for 3 with a couple of punch-outs, although Jeter Downs did walk. And neither of the pitchers, Emmanuel De Jesus and Adonir Mosqueda, pitched for the Team Venezuela in the opener. But we'll talk more about that next week because it'll be over. So, Ian, let's just jump right in then to our rankings update. We had a new rankings update go live today. Our first, in which we should mention, Ian, our newest member of the Sox Prospects brass, James Dunn, joined us as a member of the brass recently. We're pumped about Dunzo joining us in running the site. He's been a contributor to Sox Prospects for a while now, and we're pumped to have him on the brass to do keep doing some great work. And taking over some stuff behind the scenes. So he joined us in the rankings this month, but really didn't change things too dramatically that we wouldn't have probably changed anyway. And I guess we'll start from the top, Ian, looking at the very top of the rankings. Looking at the top 10, there's only really one big change with an entry into the top 10. But the first thing that sticks out to me, Ian, is the fact that six of the top 10 players in the system right now are not playing games for Red Sox affiliates this week, which kind of sucks. Because Casas, Downs, and Duran, your top three prospects in that order, are all at the qualifier. And then Tanner Houck, Connor Siebold, and Thaddeus Ward are all on the IL, as we talked about last week. So that kind of
Yeah,
stinks.
it's not ideal.
It stinks.
Yeah, I
It's no
mean,
fun.
if Gilberto Jimenez hadn't moved up, it would have been the top four. But thankfully, we got him back where he belonged at number four. So
Yes.
that was good that he's at least playing. Well, I guess he wasn't playing actually for a few days
Yeah,
also.
he didn't play from like
So
for
it was
three
like
days,
three
I
days
think.
or something. Yeah. So actually, it's just been a
That would have
weird
been
year for
bad.
injuries.
The other big story in the top 10, Ian, is the new number 9 prospect up from number 24. A pretty damn big jump. And we should mention actually the other thing was Garrett Whitlock graduating
Yeah.
from being the number 4 prospect. So technically everyone from 4 down moved up one.
Right. And now he's throwing the slider too, which is good. He's
Well,
adjusting
he's
after
throwing
the
different sliders, which
Well,
is why.
the league made an adjustment to him and now he's adjusting again. It's just good to see. I think it's encouraging that he's making these changes in order to have, three pitches in distinct like velocity bands.
But anyways, Brian Bello, let's talk about him. He's our pitcher of the month for the month of May, Ian. At press time, 21 and a third innings, 2.11 ERA, 0.84 WHIP, 30 Ks to 4 walks. Electric stuff that he has shown in the outings. I admittedly only watched one of his most recent start, but we've heard great reports on him from the end of last season, from Fall Instructional League, and now from this month. And it's a trend that's continuing, and that's why, just to be clear, he's not moved up to number 9 because of his numbers this month. He's moved up to number 9 because of the reports of the stuff and how the stuff has looked. And he looks damn good, man.
Yeah, like I watched a couple of his starts and I've talked to someone who saw one of them. And I just think it's, as you said, it's a continuation of what we've seen since he kind of signed almost, is that he's been someone who's just constantly gotten better year after year. And he made a jump at Instructs last year where, he was all of a sudden like 93 to 96 after we had heard he was more like 91 to 93, 92, 94 before. So that's like a full grade on your fastball right there. Now he's sitting like 96 to 98, like 95 to 97. It's mid 90s to high 90s, and he's touching 99 to the Red Sox have said he's touched 100. And I think it was Julian McWilliams' article they talked about it. Like, I mean, his fastball velocity is among the best in the system now.
And the secondary pitches are they're improving too. You know, the changeup is changeup's his best pitch still, best secondary pitch. The slider's getting a lot more interesting. He seems to kind of have like two variations of it. He kind of changes the shape on it. There's like a shorter, more cuttery one, and then a longer, more vertical one. But development of that breaking ball is key, because I was talking to scouts who saw him at Instructs extensively last year, and the whole thing was like, you guys should put him up as like a 4 or 5 for now, because I think there's definitely a chance there. But for what I'm turning in, I have to put him as a reliever, because the third pitch isn't there for us right now. And this is obviously, you know, a snapshot in time. And that third pitch is starting to come along, in addition to his fastball going up another half a grade to a full grade, depending on, like, I don't know if I'd call it a full grade right now, but at least a half a grade on his fastball again in velocity. Like, it's just a really interesting arm. And as you said, the results are there, and it just matches up with the scouting reports. And, you know, it was one of those things that coming out of Greenville, which with the way this the new minor league system is set up, it's really good for scouting, because you get to see all the starters. You know, you're guaranteed you're going to see all 5, 6 of them, whatever. And
in one physical location.
Exactly. Yeah. And I was asked, and I was like, okay, who's the best pitcher you saw? And he's like, Bayo, not close. Yeah. And, you know, it's hard to argue with that.
Yeah. Yeah. On a rotation that's not bad. I mean,
no, and that's the thing. It's like Jay Groom is, I think, what, 14th, 13th?
Yeah. And we'll talk about him in a minute. Yeah.
Exactly. You know, he had his troubles to start the year. He's kind of righted the ship now. Chris Murphy's in the 20s. Brian Van Bell is in like the back of the list or close to it. Chase Shugart also is in that, you know, 50 to 70 range. Like, it's got some
good relievers,
some decent guys in the bullpen, like Alex Scherf, who maybe we'll talk about in a little bit. Jacob Wallace, like, those are all guys, you know, who are ranked, and he just is blowing them away, and he's got the best stuff. It's a combination of the best stuff, and it's just he's just so loose and athletic that there might be untapped potential here. And that's why, you know, he made such a big jump, and it was something that we kind of had been hedging. And I think it wouldn't have been as big of a jump if we had been able to go down to spring training, because we would have seen like minor league action. We would have seen this, and we would have had him higher already. Mm-hmm. As a hedge, but because we were missing that gap, and those were more or less close to very few people saw that, let's be honest.
Yeah, no, that's a very, very good point.
It makes the jump look bigger than it would have been if we had that information.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's fair. That's fair. So there's some correction happening. And then the thing too is, it's just the first month of the minor league season has been so weird. So this is probably going to keep happening for another couple of months.
Yeah, and it's like this. Just when we're making these changes, though, it's just we're not looking at the numbers only. Like,
it's part of it.
They're good at influencing and, you know, giving us an idea of who we need to ask about. But we're going out and getting information and watching the games, either in person for some levels. Like, you know, you went to Salem. I've been to Worcester, places like that. We'll be going to Portland, Worcester. Hopefully, maybe I'll get down to Greenville at some point this year. But it's also that, you know, we're reaching out and talking to our contacts and getting that information. And when they're backing up what the numbers are saying, that's when we feel comfortable making a jump like this.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. Going down to the 11 to 20 range. And by the way, go to SoxProspects.com to see the rankings in full. We're not going to narrate them here. But, you know, looking at the next group, no real big movers in this range. But one guy I wanted to mention that you mentioned his name, Ian, was Jay Groom. Who the numbers are not good if you're just scouting the line. Had a couple of bad starts to start the year, but has shown signs recently. His second to last start was cruising until he got to the fourth, at which point I think he recorded an out or two and then like walked three guys and just lost his control completely and came out, and like all the guys he walked came in. So they count against his ERA. But then his last time out, he's a candidate for pitcher of the week this week. He's not winning it, but went 5 innings. I think he allowed one run, but it, you know, only allowed one hit. I think the run was like a walk, a sacrifice or something. It was like the guy came around and like, I don't think there was a hit involved. I think it was like a walk, a wild pitch on a steal. Yeah, it was a walk, a wild pitch on a steal, and then a sac fly. So, but he had a good, really good start last time out as well. And who, you know, he technically dropped one spot with Ronaldo Hernandez moving up one spot, Ian, but he's a guy who could move a lot of spots in either direction as soon as next month, I think.
Yeah, you know, he's a tough one because with his first couple of starts, it wasn't just the numbers were bad. It was talking to people who were there and he was not good. Like his stuff was just meh. It was, you know, 89 to 92.
Not throwing strikes, like, getting hit.
Yeah, just it wasn't the curveball wasn't pure. Like, the changeup is still below average. You know, the stuff was not good. And yeah, I mean, the last two starts have been better. There's still, though, it's one of these things that I don't know what to do with Groom, because, you know, in the first one, he got into the third inning and didn't hold his stuff, which is definitely a concern. And then he still, like, if you look at it, he threw the same number of pitches in that fourth start as he did in his fifth start. You know, he hasn't got above 63 pitches this year.
Well, but they're doing that with everybody.
I understand that, but, like, and I'm assuming it's going to ramp up as the season goes on.
Sure.
But, like, we
is he going to keep his stuff?
Yeah, that's the thing with him, is, like, I need to see him, what he's throwing pitches, you know, 75 to 90 rather than, like, 60 to 75. Because every time I've seen him and talked to scouts who've seen him work any sort of length into the game, the stuff has dropped off pretty considerably. Mm-hmm. And that's still the thing we don't know with him. And that's why it's just so – he's just such a tough guy to rank, because there's such a wide range of outcomes still.
Yeah, yeah. And it's you know, we want to see him holding it deeper into games. I just want to see him, like, pitching well. I mean, because consider the fact that Alex Spear tweeted this the other day, that a lot of people within the organization thought he was a guy that was going to need some time to get his feet underneath him. Because, yeah, he was at the alternate site last year. But he hasn't pitched in a real game since, like, 2017? Like, which is crazy
to
think
about. Well, no, he threw in Lowell in 2019.
Okay, that's true. All right, so he had a few games
in
Lowell.
He threw, like, three. It was, like, two games in Lowell, I think. Because it was one.
Weren't they, like, two-inning starts or something like that, though?
Yeah, it was one regular season and one playoff, or one regular season and two playoffs, because I was at all of them. But, yeah, it wasn't, like, anything of length. He has not thrown deep in the game since, like, 2017 in Greenville. Yeah.
Yeah. Which, like, I mean, when I said the other day, I tweeted, I went back to try and find, like, I was honestly looking at it, I was like, was that his best start of his career? Not that it was this electric
Probably.
Outing, but, like, well, no, he had a bunch of really good starts in 2017.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Yeah. He had a bunch of, like, 5 and 6 inning really good starts in 2017. So it wasn't his best start ever, but it was certainly his best start since, like, August of 2017, which is insane to think about. So, He's a guy that, for me, if he goes out in his next few starts and is not good, he will probably be dropping on my list. And again, it's not scouting the stat line. It's like, is he throwing strikes? Is he getting hit? Like, you can see that. I'm going to be watching his starts. How does it look? Of course, all of the camera angles in the minor leagues make it impossible to scout lefty stuff. But, you know, it's... Or, you know, does he go out and shove over the next month, you know, and make me think, huh, all right, you know, because look at who's ahead of him. Ronaldo Hernandez, Noah Song, Brian Mata. You know, Hernandez is hitting okay in Portland. Could be hitting a little better. Song is not pitching. Mata is not pitching. Groom could easily pass all of them for me next month.
Well, the thing is, yes, and Song and Mata won't be pitching, so.
Well, that's what I'm saying, is, like, they're not pitching anytime soon. You know, Nick York at 10. Is off to kind of a rough start, although he's kind of riding the ship a little bit less of late. Jay Groom could easily be your number 10 prospect next month. He could also be outside of the top 20 if he goes out and stinks. So we'll see what happens with him. Looking in at the next group of guys from 21 to 30, the one we both kind of hit on as the guy we wanted to mention is Josh Winkowski, a guy who's the runner-up for unofficially for pitcher of the month this month. He's at a 1.33 ERA, 0.89 whip, 26 Ks to 9 walks in 27 innings. And so Winkowski, as again, another part of that Franchy Cordero, Andrew Benintendi deal, off to a really nice start.
Yeah, I mean, his last start was insane. I don't know if you watched it. He was 7 innings, 1 hit, 9 strikeouts. Just
pitcher of the week this week, I should for last week.
It's also interesting. He's one of the few guys they have working deep. He's throwing, you know, 80, 90 pitches a game.
Mm-hmm.
But, yeah, I mean, his stuff is just – the stuff is ticked up. You know, he's fastballs in the mid-90s now. He's still showing some good secondary pitches. And he's just been very impressive. I would say he's probably been the best starting pitcher not in the high minors this season for them, because Bayo's obviously low minors. So I think that, you know, it's just a weird one because,
yeah,
you know – how much of it is real, how much of it is not, you know, how much of it is him standing out because, frankly, that Portland, you know, pitching staff has not been off to the best start. You know, it's things like that we need to see and just got to see more from him. And he's someone we're definitely need to get up and get some eyes on because watched on TV and heard the reports have been encouraging, but there's still, I mean, we talked about it with all the pitchers in the system. There's just a lot of reliever questions with a lot of guys.
Yeah. Yep.
And he's another one with those. So we'll see.
Again, another guy who's going to have to be protected from the Rule 5 draft this coming off season as well. It's probably a good spot, Ian, to mention something we were talking about before the show, and that's just generally the new minor league schedule and what that does for player evaluation or two-player evaluation, in the sense that you're facing the same team over the course of a week, which on the one hand, you know, does that count as the I want to see a guy two times through the league? Right, like where the scouting report gets around and that kind of thing. But like, after facing a guy in five games, do you really not know how to pitch him on Sunday?
Well, that's
there's that piece of it. The other piece of it that I think cuts in the other direction is, you've got guys that like have played three teams a month into the season. Or two teams, 3 weeks into the season. Like, that was happening with Worcester guys. Dollar in the tip jar.
And they played Buffalo twice.
That's what I'm saying. They played Buffalo twice and Syracuse twice, maybe. No.
I think so, yeah.
No, they played Lehigh Valley last week.
They played Lehigh Valley, yeah.
So, but it's just kind of like, it's the scenario and the phenomenon we used to get in the Gulf Coast League, Ian. Where they were playing there's four teams in their division that they don't play anyone else. If the three lineups you're facing all stink, then your pitchers are going to have really good years. And I remember, I always think back to the year that the GCL rotation included Anderson Espinoza, Logan Allen, Roniel Raudes, and I never remember the fourth guy, who all had phenomenal numbers. But I just remember looking at it and being like, Logan Allen faced two teams all summer. What if those two lineups stink?
Well, like, we've seen that before. Like, I think a good example of that is, I think I mentioned it, it might have been the last episode or maybe just without talking, like the Asheville pitching staff is atrocious. And Greenville went in there and put up a ton of runs, and their lineups got like the statistics or their overalls got shoved way up because of that.
Yeah.
And they're going to play Asheville like five more times this year or something.
Yeah.
And it's like, when you have a week against, and when you have a six games against a horrific, or like when Salem played that Frederick team, or it was Fredericksburg.
Yeah, exactly. Like, exactly.
They put up like 10 plus runs three times, I think, in that series too. Yeah. Like, stuff like that happens, it's going to really skew statistics.
We've added back an unofficial rule, like not a rule, because we're not going to necessarily, it's just kind of a guide. But we're trying not to put more than we put a poll out on Twitter of, you know, asking our readers, who do you think will be the player of the week? Who do you think will be the pitcher of the week? It's not what decides the award, because, you know, it's too easily influenced by like family members and stuff like that. The Winkowskis came out in force a couple times already, for example. But
not that there's anything wrong with that.
No, there's nothing wrong with it at all. Love it. I love the excitement about it, but it's like, you know, we're seeing what people think and trying to create some excitement about who we're going to pick. But it's just kind of like, we don't want to have more than two guys from the same team on it. It's basically the rule we used to have when the Red Sox had an affiliate in Lancaster, right? It's this, like, you don't want to have a poll that's four Lancaster guys because they play in a, you know, in a launching pad. I don't want to have a poll with four Salem guys because they played Fredericksburg. You know, so it's going to be
you don't want too many Worcester guys after they have a homestand with the wind blowing out every
right,
game.
Right. So we'll see how it plays this year. You know, we'll see how, you know, this past week, the pitchers, there were five guys up for four spots in our poll, all from Portland and Greenville, you know? So it's just like, is that the teams they played? Is that just all those guys happen to have a good week? We'll see. But that's a really interesting phenomenon. We'll be keeping an eye on that. Ian, looking at 31 to 40, guy we wanted to mention is up from 42 to 35 is Cameron Cannon, and up from 43 to 38 is Sadan Rafaela. Two guys we wanted to briefly mention. Why don't you hit Cannon first, and then I'll hit Rafaela.
Yeah, he's off to a good start. I think we've talked about him a few times, just that, you know, he does look much more comfortable at the plate, and he's putting together much better at bats. Let me bring up the numbers quickly. He's had like all, he's like one for his last 13 or something in it, and because we're so early in the season, it's dropped his average like 30 points
right,
or something.
Right.
But And that, again, kind of could be the phenomenon you're talking about. You know, they figured him out after three games. But I just think that the things I'm liking are, you know, he's rocking a 14% K rate in high A and 6% walk rate, which is fine. And it's one of those things that he, if you remember back to 2019 in Lowell, he was swinging at the first pitch and just being super aggressive. Yeah. And he's just putting, from the games I've watched, he's putting much better at-bats together. And, I mean, he's already surpassed his home run total from 2019. Like, he's hitting for more power, and there are definitely issues. Like, defensively, I have no idea where he's going to play, for example, which is obviously a kind of a problem.
Right.
But, right. Yeah, if he just keeps hitting, then, you know, he's someone who can kind of reestablish his prospect status back in, like, the 20 to 30 range, which I think he was, you know, kind of when he entered the system as a second-round pick. We forget, he was their first pick in 2019, I believe, like, because they had that weird thing where they lost,
I think people think of him as a first rounder for that reason, though. Like, I think it actually goes the other way unfairly to him, is because he was the first pick. People expect first round results out of him, and he's a second rounder. Like,
yeah, but like, anyway, but he was their first draft pick that year, and like he entered, I think, in the 20 to 30 range, or maybe he was a little bit higher. But yeah, it's just good to see him hitting, because that was the, you know, talking to amateur scouts when they signed it, the whole thing was he can hit, and then they tried to change his swing mechanics and that didn't work. And it's just good to see him being comfortable again.
Yep. And I want to mention Rafaela. You know, I talked about him last episode as a really athletic guy who I kind of liked seeing him in Fredericksburg with the Salem team. And he's basically played his way to the point where he's kind of the starting center fielder on that team now, instead of Jimenez, in part because Jimenez was down for those games. But like, he's playing center field and pushing Jimenez to right field a lot lately, which is very interesting. Also playing third base and second base, and he's played shortstop once as well. But I just like him as an athletic guy who I think that the scouting will be ahead of the numbers if things are going right for a while. You know, he's not a guy who's going to put up loud numbers at this point of his career, I don't think.
Especially because he's not physical at all. He's like 5'7", 5'8".
He's thin as heck.
Really,
I actually put a video of him beating out a ground ball, a video on our Instagram, at Sox Prospects, so check that out. Where, by the way, we should also mention, Ian, we've got a really good side-by-side that you put together of Gilberto Jimenez's right-handed and left-handed swing. That's on our Twitter as well, at Sox Prospects.
Oh, can I mention something on that briefly?
Yeah.
I don't remember who it was. I think it was Chris Smith, like, mentioned his splits and how he's hitting much better against, as a lefty than a righty. And I do think that he's a weird one where you can't really look at his splits because his left-handed swing is literally geared to just punching the ball and play and running to first base. So by definition, it's going to be, in my opinion, a higher average, because he's going to make more contact and he's putting it in a position where he can just run. And like, a lot of that is weak infield singles or, like, you know, ground ball singles, things like that. Like, he's not really looking to drive the ball, whereas when he's hitting right-handed, he actually is trying to, like, go up there and have more of, like, a not professional at bat, but, like, he's more trying to drive the ball and stay back.
Yeah.
And as a result, you know, the average I don't think is going to be as good for that reason, because he's not getting those cheap freebies out there.
Yeah, it's you have to look at the full line, look at the on-base, look at the slugging. You know, is he actually hitting for any power from the right-hand side? And if you look at his splits this year, you know, against right-handed pitchers, 390, 446, 475 versus left-handers, 190, 190, 381. Note the nearly 200 isolated power there. So,
well, exactly, yeah. And it's also super small sample, but yeah, it's just super small,
consider plate with appearances.
With his, like, with the way his left-handed swing is inherently, he's going to run a higher average than he probably should from that side.
Yeah, exactly. So, anywho, yeah, very interesting stuff. Anyway, getting back to our rankings, Ian, we just mentioned in the back end in the kind of 41 to 60 range, a lot of guys that we're keeping an eye on, some guys who have popped up. I don't know if there's anyone you want to highlight from there. I mean, Alex Scherff, I think did we talk about Scherff last time and what he's doing in the bullpen in Greenville?
I think we did. He's been pretty solid after that first outing.
Tyreek Reed dropping bombs.
Yeah, we like Tyreek Reed. I think Caleb Wirt's the main one.
Yeah.
Just because he's someone that I've seen him twice this year already. The stuff's looked good. You know, he's been like mid-90s, pretty good slider.
really nice separation. I think that was the biggest thing. You know, he looks like someone who should throw that power slider in, like, you know, the high 80s. Mm-hmm. But he's more like an 81 to 83. And I think it plays well with his fastball. And he's just got some funk in the delivery because he's huge and it just gets on hitters quick. So he's someone that I think has kind of pitched his way into contention for. I mean, there's not a high ceiling or anything, but, you know, if things go really, you know, Brazier doesn't come back and Colt Brewer's still struggling, he might be someone we see in contention for a bullpen role at some point this season.
Yeah, it's going to be interesting to see how they play it with Ort, because they have, you know, we mentioned the 40-man roster, and this week we saw the Red Sox demote Franchy Cordero and call up Colton Brewer to go back to a 3-man bench, which I think I'm back to not having as much of a problem with, Ian, just because...
Well, I think they're doing it because they have 10 straight days, right, with games?
Yeah, they
I
have
believe.
10 straight games, yeah. Yeah, they have 10 straight days of games. Although I think that include the day they got rained out.
Yeah, so it did. But now it's taking. But it's they're now making up a game on the day that was going to be the end of that stretch.
Oh, jeez.
So,
okay.
Because it's next Monday is when they're making it up, or June 7th or whatever. June, so
I thought it was, 6th, yeah, I guess
7th.
I thought it was the 5th, but maybe it's the 7th.
Whatever. It's sometime next week.
Yeah.
Whatever.
So at any rate, yeah. I mean, that it's that in part, and I think it's just also like the thing is they I want to say it was probably Cotillo that reported it, but it may not have been him that said that Ryan Brazier might be kind of close to going out on a rehab assignment. So I think Brewer is really just keeping Brazier's seat warm, because when Brazier comes back, they're going to activate him, you know? And the thing
I think it has to be.
The problem is that with Brazier on the 60-day IL, they're going to need to make a 40-man move to add him back. So you're going to have to make a 40-man move in the next couple of weeks, in theory, to get Brazier back. But like, what are you going to do with, you know, with these 40 man spots if you're adding Caleb Ort, if you're adding Jaron Duran, if you're adding all these guys that aren't on the 40 man? Yeah, okay, Brewer is fungible. I'm fine with DFAing Brewer. Brandon Brennan is a guy who you just got that, yeah, I guess you could try and pass him through waivers again, but like, it's like you're robbing Peter to pay Paul, DFAing Brandon Brennan to add Caleb Ort. Like, maybe he's better, but like, unless you're talking about a guy that's actually going to impact the late innings, it's just not worth doing right now. So I think you're going to wait and see them hold off on making those kind of moves for the short term. Once Brazier comes back, it's kind of like with the offense, how we kept saying Danny Santana getting activated and them seeing what Danny Santana can do was the, that was kind of the point at which you were going to start seeing them do things on the offensive side. Not too long thereafter, we see Cordero go down. We see Dahlbeck lose his starting spot, at least against right-handers. I think pitching-wise, Brazier coming back is when you're going to start seeing maybe a bit of a chain reaction, start seeing things happen. So we'll have to see how that goes, but it's very interesting on that side of the ball. But yeah, that's the rankings. Again, check them out at SoxProspects.com. Hit us up with any email questions you have about the rankings, thoughts, concerns. Like I said, hit us up. We want to talk about what you want to hear about. And that's probably a good transition into our emails for this week, Ian. And our first email comes from Mad Dog. And Mad Dog says, "Hello, guys. Was wondering what your thoughts are on possibly trading Jay Groom for a young DSL pitcher, as it seems he just can't stay healthy or can't stay consistent. He's becoming too old for the lower minors and still can't seem to get anything going." He sent this 6 days ago, so it was before Groom's most recent start. But again, like, you have to look beyond the full line. Groom's prior start wasn't bad until he kind of fell apart at the end of it. You don't just trade guys for a young DSL pitcher. Like, you're not going to get anything. Put yourself in the other team's shoes. If you're...
Well, I mean, no. That's not. I don't think that's fair. Like, they got Christian Kos for Yoan Ibar. Like,
but what's wrong with Ibar? Like,
well, it was the exact same situation they would be in with Groom. They needed to clear the 40-man spot for a guy not on the 40.
Right, but I guess my point is, trading Jay Groom for Christian Kos right now is not a deal I want them to make.
Oh no, I agree with you there.
That's
but
what I'm saying.
But all I was saying is that, like, I don't think, like, the premise is, like, faulty. Like, this is a kind of trade that does happen. Like, we literally saw it last year, a guy on the 40 man for a guy off one, because
I don't think he's saying the 40 man spot. I think he's just saying he's not consistent, he's becoming too old for the lower
minors.
That's
not the reason you would do it is the reason I said it's right. The 40 man spot, it's not because you're like down on Groom, it's that you literally have no choice.
But that's the trade you make when you're about to DFA a guy.
Well, exactly. It's like, it's like what who's it? The Phillies did it with Davey Grion, or well, they didn't do it because they're the Phillies, but where they just DFA'd him and then the Red Sox claimed him immediately.
Milwaukee, like, Brewers traded Billy McKinney to the Mets after they DFA'd him because the Mets just needed warm bodies.
Well, no, but like, I think the Ibar one is the comparison. Like, it's,
but
it's
I don't think prospect. It's a good comparison because Yoan Ibar was a guy we had like 30th in our rankings.
Yeah, but it's a prospect you like, but you might not want to wait out the timetable on him.
But the thing is, you're trading him for a guy of equal value because that's what he is. This is saying, I'm saying it's too early to put Groom in that category.
I know. I'm just saying that, like, I'm not saying I agree with like trading for DSL arm. I'm saying that I wouldn't rule out at some point seeing if they decide we don't want to carry him for this much longer. We can trade him to a team that's rebuilding who can, you know, we can get something of value for him and they can, you know, deal with it the rest of his recovery.
But my point, I mean, just with the player that Groom is right now, I don't think you're going to get anything for him because it's a guy who...
No, but you are. Because, like, if you can get Christian Kost for Yoan Ibar and you said Jay Groom has more value than Yoan Ibar, by definition, you definitely could at least get Christian Kost for him.
But he's got question marks. I mean, I guess you could get Christian Kost for him, but I mean...
Right, you can get... But that's a person of value. Saying you can get no value for him, I think, is just not true at all. Like, you can get something for Groom.
You can't get value that's worth it.
You're not going to get a top 20 prospect for him, but you can get something, like... That isn't like organizational filler.
And my point is that right now is not that. All I'm saying is that it's way too soon to do that right
now.
Yeah,
no, I agree with you.
That's all my point is.
And that's fine. I agree with you. I was just saying that it's not like I wouldn't rule out that happening at some point that they decide we.
But what's some point for you? Because for me, that's not anytime soon. And I think that's what the emailer is saying.
It's
like,
it's not imminent. No, it's not imminent. No.
And it's not next month and it's not July.
So it would be like around the trade deadline this year. Maybe you look at it if you're thinking about it, or if not, it's like, you know, next year, like at some point.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, there's a long way off and there's a lot of games to be played between now and then. And our other email comes from Patreon supporter Al. And Al says, "Hey, Chris and Ian, thank you for transitioning the podcast to weekly. I never miss an episode and I'm very excited about getting to hear from you both more often. Question. Aside from a rough first outing, Brandon Workman has been lights out in the Woo Sox bullpen. When the Red Sox signed him, Alex Cora talked about the need for Workman to regain his fastball velocity in order to be effective against MLB hitters. So, has he done that? Is it time to start hoping for his return to Fenway as a late-inning reliever, or is Workman's success at AAA simply the result of his learning how to pitch against less advanced hitters, even without his usual velocity?" Ian, I'll pull up Workman's numbers, but when we saw Workman, the stuff didn't look great. He has been much better since then. What are you hearing about Workman?
Yeah, I mean, I the fastball is not back to what he used to be. I think what he used to be with the Red Sox was he like 93, 95 or something out of the bullpen. Like, that's just not the kind of guy he is anymore. You know, he's like, he was 88 to 90 when we saw him. I think, you know, I think he's a little higher now. It's like 89, 91, 90 to 92, which, I mean, he could probably learn to pitch at that velocity. I think to be successful, though, it's going to be like he's not going to be able to rely on the fastball like he did in the past. And I don't think we're ever going to, you know, the days of him being a late inning arm are behind him. Like, and frankly, if you're the Red Sox, if you're relying on him to be a late inning arm, then your bullpen is really, really bad problems.
Or he's completely turned it around. I mean, if you look at his numbers, which is, this is why we say the perils of scouting the stat line, taking out his first start, which we have talked about. In his last six games, Workman has thrown six innings, two hits, two walks, eight Ks, including five in his last two outings, which is two innings. But again, you get into, like, against the Lehigh Valley Iron Pigs, are they just not that good?
Well, right. And I think, you know, as a point of reference in that same amount of time, I think Caleb Ort has, like, 15 strikeouts in nine innings or something. Or, you know, like, it's like, it's all relative, and I do think that Workman is getting more comfortable, and they're clearly working with him. I think there was an article, I don't remember who wrote it, talking about how they want him to use his cutter more because he's basically, like, we saw him, he threw one cutter out of his 20-something pitches, and they're trying to get him to throw his cutter more, which to me it signals that the fastball still is not back, which we know. But the breaking ball did look decent. You know, he threw a couple good ones, he hung a few. So if he can get that cutter back, you know, to being at least an average pitch, and he has the breaking ball, you can pitch with diminished velocity. Like, we see guys pitch at 90 to 91, you know, 90 to 92. But it's just, that's just not a late inning type of profile anymore, though.
It's weird because in his last three outings, he has thrown 34 pitches, 27 of which have been strikes, which is obviously a very good ratio. But again, I need to see it for an extended, a longer period than this.
Definitely.
It's a very small sample size.
Well, and again, they're going to run into the same issues we talked about with the bullpen. 40-man. With Orr.
Yeah. So you got to add him to the 40 man. Is he actually better than Brandon Brennan? I don't know. Maybe he is. Maybe he isn't. They're going to have to figure that out. But again, podcast at SoxProspects.com. We want to talk about what you want to hear about. And Ian, let's wrap it up. You can follow us on Twitter. The site's account is at SoxProspects. You can follow Ian at Ian Cundall. That's IanCundall. Follow me at SP Chris Hatfield. We want to give a shout out to Joe, Podcast Joe 2.0, our producer, editor extraordinaire, who is probably just more responsible for you all being able to hear this than we are. So thanks to Joe for that. Thanks to the Ludlow Thieves for our intro and outro music. And thank you all for emailing and supporting us on patreon.com/SoxProspects. We'll be back at you next week. Maybe we'll have a player meeting later to talk about. I'm sure we're going to have plenty to talk about in the coming week.
I think we will.
So that'll be an interesting thing to gab about with Ian. I'm Chris. Thank you all for listening. We'll be back in your eardrums soon.